Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Runner's World, Race Everything. How to conquer any race at any distance in any environment and have fun doing it. By Bart Yasso, with Aaron Strout. Foreword by David Willey. Narrated by Patrick Lawlor. Publisher's Note. This audiobook is packaged with bonus material, which has been included on the first audio and MP3 CD. If you downloaded this audiobook in a digital format, please visit tantor.com and type Runner's World, Race Everything into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then click on PDF Extra 1. When prompted, enter the access code DISTANCE to access the bonus material. Foreword. In my 14 years as the editor-in-chief of Runner's World, I don't think I ever went to a race, big or small, where someone didn't ask me about Bart Yasso. Known for decades as the mayor of running, and now Runner's World's chief running officer, Bart is the kind of guy you're proud to call your friend, even if it doesn't make you feel at all unique. That's because Bart seems to know everyone, and everyone seems to know Bart. In airports, at race expos, at pasta dinners, and in porta-potty lines, they flock to him like long-lost relatives. And he usually remembers not only their names, but also their hometowns and marathon PRs. Many years ago, I was looking at a stack of race photos in a common area of the Runner's World offices in Emmaus, Pennsylvania, for a story we were working on. Bart walked by and stopped to look through them with us. He paused on a shot of a pack of runners who had just crossed the starting line. I can't recall what race it was, but I remember that the photo was cropped at the runners' waists. Only their legs were visible. Bart pointed to a pair of men's gams and said, "I know that guy." The runner's name has also vacated my memory all these years later, but Bart said it out loud. He might have added the guy's finishing time, too. I was too flabbergasted to notice, distracted by what I had just witnessed. Bart recognized one of his many running friends after only seeing his legs. Bart has also been known to form bonds with runners he's never met, pilgrims who know the legend of Bart, even if they don't know the man himself. Joanna Golub, a Runner's World contributor who served as our nutrition editor for several years, once went hiking on a remote glacier in Alaska, hundreds of miles from civilization. At some point, she told her guide where she worked. "Oh my God," he exclaimed, "do you know Bart Yasso?" Bart couldn't be on the glacier, but Joanna, who was just one degree of separation from the mayor, was the next best thing. Bart's renown can be traced back, at least in part, to an unplanned and unintentional PR blitz that began as a slow boil in 1981. Bart, 25 at the time, decided he wanted to qualify for the Boston Marathon. He would need to run a 2-hour, 50-minute marathon, 17 minutes faster than his PR, to do so. So he came up with a training routine to increase his speed. Once a week, in addition to his weekly workouts, he ran 800 meters on a track and then jogged 400 meters, eventually working up to 10 repetitions, or 7.5 miles of running. It worked. He qualified for Boston by 1 second. So Bart continued to include this track workout in his training for other marathons, recording the results in his running log. A few years later, he noticed an odd correlation between his marathon finishing times and the times in which he ran those 10 800-meter intervals. If he ran each interval around, say, 2 minutes and 40 seconds, his finishing time for the marathon was right around 2 hours and 40 minutes. If he ran them in 2:50, that is 2 minutes and 50 seconds, that meant he was in shape to run a 2:50 marathon. This held true for 14 out of 15 marathons he ran since adopting this training regimen. Bart thought it was an interesting coincidence, but it wasn't until he casually mentioned it to Amby Burfoot, then the chief editor of Runner's World, that what are now known to runners around the world as Yasso 800s became a thing. Amby wrote a story about the workout, and in a surprise to Bart, even named it, explaining that when astronomers discover a new star, they get to name it whatever they want, so why shouldn't Bart get the credit? If you Google Yasso 800s today, you will get more than 80,000 results. The workout, ideally done a few weeks before your goal race, has become a staple of marathon training programs for all kinds of runners, from newbies to Olympic qualifiers. But even this cannot fully account for Bart's immense popularity. Yasso 800s may have earned him some coaching cred and name recognition, but he is beloved by legions of runners today not because of what he knows. It's because of what he's done and who he is. Put simply, Bart has done more for runners and has had more fun running than anyone I know. He recounted his many adventures and accomplishments, as well as the personal crises and challenges he has overcome along the way, in his 2008 memoir, My Life on the Run. If you're listening to this, chances are you're familiar with that book already. But if you aren't, you should get familiar with it. Bart has lived an amazing life. For starters, he's traveled all over the world. His passport has been stamped with visas from Australia, New Zealand, Nepal, Peru, Kenya, Tanzania, India, and Egypt, among other far-flung nations. I guarantee that Bart met people in each of them that he would remember today if they ran into each other. Of course, Bart has run races all over the world, too, more than he can even count. But it's not just his bucket list that makes Bart's running life and this book unique. It's his perspective. Bart can relate to all kinds of runners, from the front of the pack to the back, because he has been each of those runners in his lifetime. He won a marathon in his early years, and his PR is 2:40. He finished the Badwater Ultra Marathon, widely regarded as one of the hardest foot races on earth. He's run the famed Comrades Marathon, a misnomer since the course runs at least 56 miles, depending on whether it's an uphill or a downhill year, in South Africa. He once even ran neck and neck with 1972 Olympic marathon champion Frank Shorter in a race. Despite all his accolades and achievements, Bart understands humility and remains authentically down to earth. He is personally acquainted with something all runners can relate to, regardless of how fast or slow they are: adversity. In 1990, Bart unknowingly contracted Lyme disease, and 6 years later, while climbing Mount Kilimanjaro in Africa, he suffered an attack of Bell's palsy that rendered the left side of his face and body temporarily paralyzed. These conditions have left Bart with joint pain and severe arthritis in his knee and hip. This has slowed him down, and at times it's hard for him to run more than a few easy miles. It hasn't stopped him from running. I don't think anything could. But it has given him a keen appreciation for how difficult and yet therapeutic running can be for so many people. Bart's PRs are behind him now, but he finds it just as fulfilling to participate in other ways, whether it's volunteering, coaching, race directing, or helping out with the local running club. When I started working at Runner's World in 2003, I must confess I didn't fully comprehend the power of Bart. I knew him as the guy who worked in the marketing department and rode his bike to work almost every day. At the time, Runner's World had a robust race sponsorship program. We had partnerships with thousands of events across the country. This is why so many race bibs and swag bags have been emblazoned with the Runner's World logo over the years. Bart was our point of contact with all of the race directors in the program, and he spent nearly 200 days per year on the road, attending and running in races, sometimes doing some finish line announcing or pasta dinner speaking, always connecting with runners. This is how he got to know so many people, and by extension, how he learned so much about the subculture that is road racing in America. It quickly became clear to me that the amiable guy in the office down the hall was not only a font of insight and information, but also a vivid storyteller and a remarkable ambassador for both runner's world and our sport. It also became clear that we should tap into Bart's vast knowledge and share it more widely with our readers. So, in the January 2004 issue, which came out right around the time runners were planning the coming year's race calendar, we published a feature story entitled Bart's Magical Marathon Tour. It was a roundup of Bart's favorite 26.2 milers, with quirky, plain-spoken explanations of what made each one great. It was a hit. Since then, of course, Bart has written My Life on the Run, as well as dozens of articles and blog posts about running and racing. He has continued to travel the world, connecting with runners from big cities to small towns, from war zones to Amish country. He has also trained thousands of runners and inspired thousands more simply by being a positive, motivational example for people of all ages and abilities to emulate. I've seen it and heard about it firsthand more times than I can count. A lot has changed since Bart started working at Runner's World in 1987. Race participation has exploded, and the definition of race has evolved to include relays, mud runs, adventure races, and other unconventional events. Women have entered the sport in massive numbers, and they now outnumber men in some race distances, including the half marathon. And, of course, technology has transformed the way we track our running lives and connect with one another. Bart has celebrated and embraced it all, despite the fact that the start of his running career preceded the digital age by a couple of decades. Bart took to social media instantly. After all, that's where the runners are, and now he can converse with tens of thousands of his followers at once from his office or his couch or whichever race he happens to be attending at the moment. Perhaps it was inevitable, then, that Bart's digital skills would intersect with his itinerant job description to give us a new form of social interaction. The Barty. It's no longer enough to merely meet Bart when one encounters him at a race or expo or pasta dinner. Now the interaction must be visually documented and then shared as widely as possible. Sometimes Bart snaps the Barty himself, while other times his starstruck followers do. But the essential elements are the same either way: a camera or smartphone, Bart's face, or at least some part of his head in the foreground, and a group of happy runners, the more the better, in the background. I took a Barty during the 2016 Runner's World Half Marathon in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. Bart was instrumental in founding the race, in the town where he grew up and still resides, and he designed the course himself. I don't know who the people behind us are, but Bart probably does. I keep it on my phone because it neatly represents our 14-year friendship and collaboration at Runner's World. It was the last race we ran together. Plus, I also live in Bethlehem, and the Barty reminds me of how much work and energy we put into starting that race from scratch, and of how much fun we had putting it on every year. I know for sure that none of it would have happened if not for our CRO. Bart knows as much as anyone I've ever met about races and racing. This book is a repository of all the knowledge and insider's expertise he has amassed over the decades. It's also a useful guide to running the world's very best races, from 5Ks through ultras, relays, triathlons, and unconventional events. and to running your very best in them, whatever best means to you, whether it's a PR or a first-time finish. It's packed with training plans, race day tips, nutrition advice, and other indispensable wisdom. But unlike many guides and repositories, this book is also a joy to listen to. There are two reasons for this. First, Bart's steel trap memory holds colorful details and hilarious anecdotes as easily as it stores names and faces. Second, Bart worked with the enormously talented Aaron Strout, a Runner's World contributing editor, to get a lifetime of his stories and insights into this book. As you probably know, Bart will retire at the end of 2017. If you're lucky, you might see him at one of the races he recommends here. If you do, be sure to say hello and follow it up with two simple words that only begin to account for all he has done and continues to do for the running community. Thanks, Bart. And don't forget the Barty. David Willey, July 2017. Chapter 1. The Many Reasons to Race. From fast times and personal records to adventures and camaraderie, the reasons we race are personal and diverse. It was the fall of 1977, and I was a 21-year-old who had wasted away my teen years on cigarettes, beer, and weed. I headed out for my first run in cut-off jeans cinched by a belt, a Budweiser t-shirt, and a pair of old Keds. I ran straight into a bar about a mile away. When I arrived, I celebrated by downing two beers. Then I walked home. It was an inauspicious start to a life forever changed by running. But it was a start nonetheless. I had been inspired by my daily walks with my girlfriend's dog, Brandy, who showed unadulterated joy when she was liberated from her leash, free to romp and play. Those walks eventually morphed into runs by myself, gradually enjoying my own sense of freedom from the dark days I had fallen into. My older brother George, one of my six siblings, took notice of a kind of metamorphosis happening, and as a father figure to me, he wanted to encourage this turning point in my life. By 1980, he goaded me into running a 10K with him in Moore Township, Pennsylvania, close to where we grew up in Fountain Hill. I had a giant, shaggy beard that covered most of my face. The other half was covered by my long, unkempt hair. It was decades before the advent of the selfie, but I looked like a running caveman. I was reluctant, and I had no idea what I was doing. But most importantly, I showed up, and when the gun went off that morning, I shot out in a 5:20 first mile, naively going with a group of seasoned competitors in the lead pack. By mile two, I was predictably suffering a slow death and waning pace. By mile three, I wanted to vomit. George pulled away and never looked back. When I crossed the finish line in about 40 minutes, I had placed 40th out of 240 people. Not bad, I thought. Something inside was stirred. When I headed back to my car that day, the windshield was covered with flyers advertising other upcoming races in the area, the 1980s equivalent of email marketing. George was smart enough to appeal to my competitive nature and challenged me to a rematch. 3 weeks later, we were back on a 10K starting line, this time in Easton, Pennsylvania, where I was struck by the challenge as well as a new feeling of purpose. I held myself back for the first few miles, then surged past George around mile five. By the time I reached that finish line, I was aware on some subconscious level that my life would never be the same. I was grateful. And I was, of course, hooked. I couldn't wait to run my first marathon. Those first races left me hobbling around for days afterward. In no way could I fathom that by trying a couple of 10K races, I was embarking on a running career that would span more than 40 years. I didn't know that this sport would take me to events all around the world on all 7 continents, running in at least 1,200 of the approximately 1,800 races I have attended. I've gone on to contest distances from 1 mile to 146 miles from Antarctica, South Africa, India, and Rome to Death Valley, Boston, New York, and Chicago. Running has intimately connected me to a global community of active, health-conscious, and kind people. It's brought me face-to-face with some of the most inspiring athletes on the planet. What I've come to realize is that when the gun goes off, we all follow the same course to the finish line, but each of us has taken a different path to the starting line. Sometimes it's riddled with obstacles of every sort. Other times we are blessed with smooth sailing from day one. But when you line up with hundreds or thousands of others on race day, you will find hundreds or thousands of different goals, expectations, and reasons for being there, all of them valid and important. In my younger days, my sights were set on personal records and maybe even a few wins. Now that I'm in my 60s, I channel the same amount of passion toward merely finishing and experiencing the joy of moving forward. I'm a little like Elvis. My speed and a lot of my hair has left the building, but my spirit soars on. I'm now untied from my race clock, happy to let it tick away while I take my time to meet new people and look at the scenery. That wasn't always the case, though. My watch determined the success or failure of decades worth of running until time was no longer worth chasing. My first bout of Lyme disease was in 1990, just after I finished the Lake Waramaug 50-miler in Connecticut. In a short span of time, I went from running 50 miles in 6 hours and 11 minutes to struggling to cover 1 mile. I was misdiagnosed and went untreated for a long time. After I was put on the appropriate antibiotics, it took a few months to resume my running routine. I came back strong as a 43-year-old with a 2:42 at the California International Marathon. My health remained stable until 1997, and this time Lyme almost cost me my life. A tick bite that I probably sustained on the trails in Pennsylvania caused severe illness during a trip to East Africa, but I fought back again through a long hiatus to win the Smoky Mountain Marathon. A third bout of the disease awaited me in 2002, and when I left the hospital, I never regained my prior fitness level. I am humbled to run a few miles a week now, aware and respectful of what my body can muster. The people I meet in the running community inspire me to keep going. I've slowed down tremendously, but my connection with the sport has only strengthened. In this book, we'll explore not only some of the reasons to consider races of many distances, but how to train for them, which ones I've enjoyed most, and what to expect at the most unique and prestigious events I've run. I'll give you a taste of my personal experiences and why each of these races has become a special part of my running story. From Comrades, my favorite race of all time, to the Monument Avenue 10K in Richmond, Virginia, to the Runner's World Half Marathon in my own backyard of Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, I've learned how to best prepare for varying terrain, large crowds, and all kinds of weather conditions, as well as how to adjust physically and emotionally to the many unforeseen circumstances that arise when getting ready to tackle a big goal. But perhaps the greatest lesson you will glean from me is to never limit where your running can take you. Indeed, it's taken me almost everywhere, and if that can happen to me, it can happen to anyone. Run a marathon in all 50 states or on all 7 continents, or choose just one 10K. Tackle the summer 5K series in your hometown. Dare to finish an ultramarathon. Or gather up a team and hit the relay circuit. The running world has so much to offer to all ages and abilities, the hardest part is figuring out which path to choose. Racing defines our running, provides start dates and end dates, measures our progress, and gives reasons to celebrate. It offers a chance to learn how to prepare and how to execute. The most meaningful part of racing for me has been the opportunity to experience new cultures and see parts of the world I'd otherwise miss. My life has been molded and framed by the weekends spent traveling to starting lines around the world. It's been expanded by adventures that have happened on the way to all those finish lines. I wish the same for every runner, and I believe that no matter what your aspirations, it is racing that brings a sense of structure, camaraderie, motivation, and achievement to our running. When I travel to events as Runner's World's chief running officer, my hope is always to inspire others the way that George encouraged me so many years ago. Whatever your reason, you, too, can race everything. Why race? The people on the sidelines shaking their heads, grumbling about the street closures, may never understand why so many of us rise with the roosters, put on our sneakers, and head to starting lines around the world every weekend. The easier choice is to sleep in, linger over the Sunday morning coffee, and read the newspaper. Not all people who run choose to race, of course, but I've found that putting events on the calendar can lead to all sorts of good results, not only the kind that are measured by times and personal records, but those less tangible quality of life ways, too. Here are my top reasons runners should consider racing. 1. Accountability. Running every day is an accomplishment. Heck, running just a few times a week is an accomplishment, too. But registering for a race and forking over some hard-earned dollars gives your running increased importance and priority. Now you're accountable because you have to be prepared to run to the best of your ability on a specified date. That doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to run your fastest, but it does mean you have committed to train as well as you can to cover the distance. Sometimes you just need to give yourself a deadline, and a race will inevitably jumpstart your routine. 2. Fitness tests. Often, races are just measuring sticks, opportunities to gauge where our fitness is and where it needs to improve. It's easier to give yourself an honest check when you've pinned a race bib to your shirt and lined up with other people. You're not there to compare yourself with everybody else, but the presence of those around you can bring more out of you than just another time trial by yourself. This isn't a pass-fail test. It's just a way to find out what you need to work on next. 3. A change of scenery. Every runner gets stuck in a rut once in a while, when training feels forced and the drudgery of the routine starts to wear us down. To me, that is the perfect time to scan the internet for events that offer some sort of new challenge or are in a place you've wanted to visit but never had reason to go. You can find races in every corner of the world if you look hard enough. Finding one that stokes new inspiration or excitement can get you back on track. 4. Camaraderie. I say it over and over again, but truly the greatest gift that running has given me is this global community of like-minded people, most of whom I've met because of all the races I attend. If you train mostly on your own and you are looking for buddies, the first place to find them is at a race. You can strike up a conversation with just about anybody, and it's not even awkward. There's a genuine, we're all in this together mentality among runners on a starting line. 5. Inspiration from the top. One of the most unique parts about our sport is that anybody of any age or skill level can run the same race as the professional athletes. Those poor saps who take to the league basketball team will never play in the same game or on the same court as Steph Curry. But we runners line up behind Shalane Flanagan, Desiree Linden, and Meb Keflezighi all the time. They may finish hours ahead of us, but we're following in their footsteps every step of the way. And that's pretty cool. 6. Inspiration from everywhere else, too. I leave races in awe of the accomplishments of so many different kinds of people. There are the older runners still crushing their goals. Then we see the newer people, some of them trying to lose a few pounds or just run farther than they ever have before. People run while fighting cancer and other illnesses. Their strength and determination is beyond admirable. If you're looking for motivation, it's everywhere. If you leave a race without being touched by it, make sure you still have a heart. 7. Be better than before. Most of us aren't there to win any prize money, though if that is your goal, more power to you and good luck. Races are the obvious place to go to be our best, to try to run faster than we ever have before. It's you against the clock, you against a former version of yourself. A race can be a big turning point, a confidence booster, and an indication that you have more ability than you thought possible. Dreams come true at races. Just stand at the finish line for 15 minutes and watch the reactions of everybody reaching new heights. 8. Lend encouragement. Even on the days that don't go our way, these events are also a setting where we can help others achieve their goals. If you're not feeling 100%, don't hit snooze. Wake up, get yourself to the starting line, and help somebody else. Pace a friend, or merely cheer on the people around you. You'll be surprised how fulfilling it can be to spur somebody else on to her own greatness. 9. Support a good cause. So many events now donate proceeds to charities. Even if you're not looking to blaze a new personal record, you can still sign up to run and know that your money is doing some good in the community. 10. Long run support. If you're at that point of marathon training when the long runs are getting really long, signing up for a race as part of that day's training can help the miles fly by. If you have a 20-miler on your plate, make a 10K part of it by running some of the miles beforehand and some afterward. The race portion of the long run can serve as a tempo or as the pace work portion of the run. You'll have instant running buddies, water stops, and even restrooms readily available should you need any of those amenities. And you'll probably get a medal or a t-shirt for your efforts, which never happens after your typical Sunday morning grind. 11. Fun. Right! Did I forget to mention that running is supposed to be fun? Race events try to make it that way. Bands, food, festival-like finish line areas. It's a celebration of running. You can't help but get caught up in the atmosphere and smile. And smiling is a perfectly legal performance enhancer. We should all do it more often.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.